So welcome back. Today we're going to talk about kind of the whole brain methods. Now we're not going to get deep into that material yet. We're just going to give an overview and how the processes and the whole brain methods interplay, particularly when we're trying to come up with new ideas. Now we're kind of coming up with ideas. What really kind of stands the test of time is the more ideas that we have, the merrier. If we're only working for a solution and we only have a few ideas and we're just going to choose from that few, chances are, even statistically, that we're going to get maybe an okay idea, but we're not going to get a fantastic idea. So how do we go about maximizing this? Well, kind of in a quote that I like to bring up is the best way to have a good idea is have a lot of ideas. And this actually comes from a Nobel Prize winning chemist. Other types of thoughts on the matter are ideas are like rabbits. You get a couple and they learn how to handle them, and then pretty soon you have a dozen. Of course, that's kind of a funny thing. Then I always throw in my own two cents. So ideas are a flow of inspired associations. When focused, it can launch mankind to the stars. And that's really kind of true when you really get to the expansion of what you do with a whole bunch of ideas. So give you kind of an idea in kind of a picture format. Think of it as like a divergent-convergent situation. So that's what these diamonds are in the middle. So let's say we're taking some kind of an issue, some kind of a problem or an opportunity or an IPO, that's what we usually call those. And we want to get a solution for one of these situations. Now, on the left side, we start with the problem identification or the opportunity identification. In the middle, what we're really looking for is what we call divergent thinking. And this is where we want to get as many options for solving this or coming up with the opportunities for this. And so, as you can see in the top diamond, if we only have like three ideas, okay, well, that really gives us three to choose from. And so whatever our decision or action is on the output on the right-hand side might be good, might be okay, that's fine. But maybe it's not the best solution. So what we would rather do is, if you look at the bottom diamond, is take that issue, problem, or opportunity. And when we go to the divergent idea phase, let's get as many ideas as possible. So we have one through N, so as many ideas as we can. We'll look at how to get the best bang for the buck on those ideas in a second. And then once we have tons of different ideas, the chances that we're going to have a really good one go up dramatically. And so that's really the divergent process. And then in the end, the convergent process is when we come back and we whittle away which ideas are some of the best, which ones make most sense, which ones are implementable and all those things so that we can get to a decision or action and get a much better outcome than we would have if we only had a few ideas. Okay, so these things called whole brain methods, we're going to talk about basic ones and advanced ones. And they're in different chapters in the book. So the basic ones are really roughly in chapter 4. And so there's a whole list of them. We're not going to go into these just this second. We're going to go into them a little bit later. And if you notice, they have different pros and cons. So what's nice about this table in table 3.1 and the following tables, it kind of gives you an idea of when are they applicable? Is it something you can do as an individual or a team? And is it a highly visible process or is it not a highly visible process? So I invite you to go through and look at these so you can kind of get an idea if you were making or facilitating a process like this, which ones would be most applicable in certain situations. So for example, if you look at the one called Ono's Circle, it's not really applicable when you're trying to resolve an issue, problem, or opportunity versus defining one. And it's also something you can do on an individual basis really well, but not so much something that lends itself to a team. So that's something that you want to keep in mind, and it's a visual process. So those are some of the basic ones. And again, there's this whole list that we're going to go over in Chapter 4. When we go over in Chapter 7 is some that are a bit more advanced. I've actually added a whole bunch more. And keep in mind, this is a short list. There are probably books out there that have another 101 methods, and then there's another one that has another 100 methods on top of that. So some of them overlap, obviously, so I don't want you to get the idea that these are the only methods for creativity and innovation, but they are on some of the top end of the list of things that get used and used successfully often. So again, in Chapter 7, we've got some advanced concepts here, everything from biomimicry, freehand drawing, music, and TRIZ, and we'll talk about all of those later on in the course. And again, is it something you do as an individual or a team, or can it lend itself to both? So that's something we want to look at. So moving forward, one thing that's a preconceived notion about creativity that I want to get you over is this idea that accidental creativity is really the only way creative processes happen. You know, people are kind of born with the ability to create. In reality, a facilitated creativity is much more powerful and also includes a lot of other people that otherwise wouldn't normally be involved in the process, and you actually get better results from that. So we're not just limited to a few geniuses that are, you know, the creatives in the world. There's actually a lot more people involved in that. In fact, there was a survey taken in 2013 by Kluger of about 2,040 people. 60% of the respondents thought ideas came from sudden inspiration, which is really interesting in that survey. However, when you look in a lot of the technology development phase, there's some of that, but the actual follow-through or the actual thought development to actually get to something that can be useful is much more pragmatic. It required a lot more people. So you had to be able to harness those processes and take those sudden aha moments and now convert them into something that is actually useful. So how do we do that? We can actually harness what we know about the brain and a lot of what we've learned in neuroscience, and we can use the facilitated methods to increase this ideation dramatically, and not just for an individual, but for a team. That actually lends us to be able to tackle a whole bunch of wicked problems that otherwise we couldn't do by ourselves. Because remember, the collective intelligence of a group is always much higher than an individual, except maybe a mob mentality. That's something completely different in psychology. Okay, so let's take a note on some of the methods we're looking at. If you think about what we're doing, these are really tools. What we're giving you is a whole bunch of different tools, and then you can figure out when and where you want to apply them. And we'll give you some sense of that. There are other tools outside, again, like I said before, other than just the ones that we're talking about here. And there's always new versions of things that are being creative. So it's this ongoing process. However, when we work with a team versus an individual, one of the things we want to do is leverage what we call the Medici effect. So the Medici effect tells us, and the research tells us from Brenner, that actually if you have groups that start using methods, that's fine and dandy, but the makeup of the group matters significantly. The reason is because if you have everybody who thinks alike all getting together in a group to make a decision, really they're going to be pulling kind of from the same toolbox. And so, you know, if you think about if you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail to you. Or, you know, if you give a surgeon an opportunity to do something, their surgeons cut things out. So that's kind of the solution they're going to be looking for. However, if you get a diversity of different people, maybe a biologist, maybe a chemist, maybe somebody who is neuroscience, all these other types of ideas, there may be other ways to treat a situation. So same thing here. What you want to have is a diversity of different viewpoints, people with different skill sets. Some people are extremely well-versed in skills and areas, some experts in the field, and you want to have some people who are absolutely not experts in the field on the other end of the spectrum, because they don't have all the biases that come with that, thinking they know everything. So to combat or actually leverage the Medici effect, we want to have these large diverse groups, because then we actually have a whole bunch of different tools and you can find the right tool for the right job and come up with better solutions. So the other thing you want to do with these groups is to be able to get them to entrain to want to share their ideas and feel like they have an equal say at the table, is you always want to lead with some kind of icebreaker. Now, at the beginning of these classes, I call it the ice melter, and that was kind of the worldview exploration process. And the idea is it gives everybody a safe space to share their ideas, not feel embarrassed about it, not feel like they're going to be silly or chastised for these ideas. Because in reality, you want to have that process first. We're not going to sit there and separate the wheat from the chaff on the ideas until much later. So in the beginning, it's all about coming up with something that we've never done before, particularly in innovation. So we want to use multiple methods, and we want to be free to be foolish. And that's part of the whole creative process in the beginning. Now, again, we're going to be covering different tools in chapters 4 and in chapter 7. And if you think about it, you can do the creative process on an individual basis, because there's sometimes when you're working alone and also in teams. So let me give you an example of what it may look like. First of all, from the individual example, and then I'll give you a team example. So in an individual example, maybe we use one of the tools that we're going to learn about called Ono Circle. This is where we can observe and define a problem. So that may be the first stage. The next stage, maybe you do some brainstorming to generate many solutions to the idea. Then maybe you move to something called six thinking caps, and that's where we can analyze our different options for a solution. And then from there, we may get to a point, it's like, okay, we've gotten a point, analyzed some options, and we have some ideas. Now we want to move to the next step, maybe with a team, or maybe it's something that you continue on with. So you can see how I have a progression of tools depending upon what we're doing. Are we trying to identify problems? Are we trying to go divergent and create solutions? Or are we trying to analyze our options? So this is basically a convergent process where we're trying to whittle away at some of the ideas. So maybe that's the first pass. Then the team comes together, and now we take some of those ideas and we say, okay, let's reassess some of these problems or pain causes. Are our assumptions correct? Now we're going to do something different. So this is a fishbone diagram, different way. Mind mapping, generate many solutions or ideas. It's similar to a brainstorm, but slightly different in how it's structured. Then multi-voting to prioritize options. Now we get everybody's input as to who thinks which ideas are best. And then we move on to design, or whatever the next step is. So we've got something where we think we've got a solution that we want to move and then spend resources, both people, time, money, materials, onto the next step. So those are some different ideas of how these tools can be used in a process. We're going to get to the specific tools a little bit later, but I wanted you to be familiar with kind of the process of how they can be used. The other thing that we're trying to do here is avoid something called the Einstein effect trap, or the EET, or EET. What does this really mean? Well, the problem that we have and what the Einstein effect gives us is the difficulty lays not so much in developing new ideas, but we have to get out of our same ways of thinking from the old ideas. This comes from John Maxwell, who came up with the theory of electromagnetism. Our ideas see not only what our mind is inclined to comprehend, but we get stuck in that. So this is kind of a philosopher, Bergson talks about. It actually means, Einstellung actually means kind of mindset, attitude, or approach. And it's a German derivative. And really what it tells us is you're usually coming from something where your experiences, as we've talked about worldview and other things, your experiences actually derive some of the directions that you're going to pull knowledge from and where you're going to pull ideas from. Instinctively, everybody does this. However, we want to be able to have, and part of the leveraging the Medici effect, having diversity, is that different people are going to be pulling from different directions and pulling ideas that one person would not think of, this other person might think of. So if we want to think about how does this affect us, so let's say if we break down the steps in traditional engineering, for example, where is the Einstein effect trap hidden? So we usually look at it as like a four-step process. We have observation, recollection, reasoning, and a decision. So we observe something, it brings up ideas, so we pull from those ideas, and then we do some reasoning on, okay, which ideas make sense, and then we make a decision on it. So where do you suppose the Einstein effect trap really sets in? So if you think about it, which one of those four would it be? Well, if you chose recollection, you would be correct, because it's from those past experiences and the associative components in your mind is where you're pulling ideas from in general. So to avoid the Einstein effect trap, we want to look at each new situation in its own terms. We don't want to take it from the viewpoint of the past, like this is the way we've always done it, or this is the NASA way, or this is the whatever way. Because you want to get beyond just those simple processes to come up with something truly innovative or truly new. And that's how you can solve new processes. So, reality check. Great, we're saying all this stuff about creativity and these different ideas, and yeah, we pulled some research quotes from it. How do we know any of this? How do we know this works? Well, several different areas, both in research and experiential, have led to this evidence. So the evidence comes from, of course, experience. This is experience in corporations, this is experience personally. We call this like a noetic experience. It's a direct experience, which kind of is case studies, anecdotes, things like that, that's usually not rigorous enough. So other places where we're pulling from is research and observations of students, practitioners. This gets into different types of business research, creativity research, innovation research, and also neuroscience research, so studying the brain. So this is how the brain works, how the brain processes information and creates ideas and information. It comes from all these different areas, and we're going to leverage all of this into this class. Okay, so four ways to bring out your inner creative genius. That's kind of the goal. Number one, and I know with this generation particularly, sometimes I'll get pushback on this. The first thing that you need to learn to do is have what we call sustained focus. Now, that usually means you don't want to be multitasking. You can't be having your phone going on the background or somebody else doing something in the background or having the TV on while you're working. Really complex problems and opportunities require long periods of time focused on one thing. I call it deep think, but there's a lot of other terms for it. And so there's a lot of research that supports that that's a key to be able to find something and unlock something new. And if you look at many of the breakthroughs in technology, mathematics, engineering, and sciences back over the years, most of those breakthroughs came from long periods of digesting a problem and looking at things from different angles and deep thinking. And the irony is out of that, after that process, usually once the brain's relaxed a little bit and the subconscious is still processing, that's when an aha moment kicks in. It's not before. It doesn't happen like, hey, I have this aha moment without the deep thinking process or the sustained focus first. So as Einstein would say, it's not that I'm so smart, it's just that I stay with problems longer. And that's really kind of a testament to that. In fact, Elon Musk talks about the same types of things with his companies too. Team whole brain methods, something we want to focus on. This is what can help provide a group sustained focus, better bonding, and improved outcomes. For a team really to work, they have to have that bonding, that trust there between them to get improved outcomes. And to get sustained focus, they got to have time to actually work on that process. Methods that can help escape established ways of thinking and worldview. They become more productive and creative than going back again, what we said before, doing the same old, same old. And that's again supported by research. We also want to encourage subconscious thought processes. So allow the brain to utilize the subconscious in both divergent and convergent processes. And they are quite parallel. And this again goes back to periods of sustained focus and then periods of relaxation where you just do something else. Maybe you go work out, maybe you go meditate, maybe you get some rest, go for a walk, go in nature for a while, away from the noise. And then things will come back in through the subconscious, which is still processing in the background, and you're not even aware of it. And there's a lot of research that goes along with that. And ironically, it's that piece that people usually attribute to fortuitous accidents. But they often forget that there's usually a period of sustained focus prior to those. So there are some, you know, case studies that they like to put out. For example, the cardiac pacemaker in 1951. This was an electrical engineering student at Cornell. Greatbach accidentally inserted a wrong resistor into an oscillator, and that was truly an accident. They weren't expecting to do that. They began stimulating heartbeats rather than recording them. That was not intended, and because of that, then the sustained focus was, wait a minute, what did we just do? And so they started analyzing, what did they just do? So it was kind of started with an accident, followed by focus, and then they came up with the idea, hey, we could actually do this on purpose. Instead of an accident. So that's actually something that was kind of interesting. Vulcanization in 1844, if you're not familiar with that, that's where you can take rubber that's normally a soft material, and this was actually the entrepreneur Goodyear of, when you think of Goodyear tires, actually, that's the name they're pulling from, although Goodyear has nothing to do with it at this point. After years of trying different chemistries of raw rubber, accidentally spilled some ingredients on a hot stove and discovered the vulcanization process. And just named vulcanization after the Roman fire god. Filed a patent in 1844, but never founded Goodyear the company. Imagine that. That's kind of the irony of that whole story. Microwave oven, 1946. Again, kind of a happy accident. 1946, electrical engineer Spencer at Raytheon, very local to us, they were building a magnetron to generate EM waves in the microwave spectrum from radar. Then they suddenly accidentally noticed that the candy bar that was next to the machine melted due to the EM radiation. So again, there's an event that happened. They're like, what was that? And then they had to go through and analyze what just happened. That led to the aha moment of, hey, maybe they could actually use this once they figured out that you're actually exciting water molecules. Okay, penicillin, again, 1928. Now, there was a lot of research diving into this, but in 1928, Alexander Fleming, biologist, inadvertently contaminated slide with mold with penicillin notatum, is how it's described. Later, the notes around that the mold, right where that bacterium was gone, and it kind of led the use to later on of antibiotics, as we have learned later. So there are accidents that do happen, but just because the accident happens, unless you have the proper skill set to do some deep thinking to figure out not only what happened, but why did it happen and how did it happen, you'd miss the boat because there's probably happy accidents all over the place. But you gotta have the right education and skills and things to recognize that that's an opportunity. So in all cases, the person or team had the skill sets and the ability to recognize the implications of the accident. Without that, it would have just gone by and nobody would have observed it. Identification of the opportunity, what could they use it for, and learned how to apply the knowledge that was gained and apply it to other situations and other applications. Okay, so let's say you are part of a small business or a large company and you are involved in the innovation process and they want you to be a facilitator. Well, that's actually a great way to do the creative process. Is you get a facilitator who organizes the creative process, and it could be as short as a day, it could be as long as, you know, a week, where they just go through this process depending upon what they're trying to tackle. And you basically plan out the divergent convergent pathways for the team to follow. Usually, however, if you're going to be a facilitator, you don't really want to have a stake in it. You got to keep the team on task. Which means they have to give you that. You got to nudge them forward when they start getting resistant or stuck. You want to make sure that you engage all the team members. And again, you want to have, at best, an external facilitator, at least somebody who has a minimal stake in the outcome. The reason is because they don't get hung up on the solution. You get somebody who's more working for the process. And I've worked in teams where we had facilitators, and it's actually fantastic when you have an external facilitator because they can really deal with egos and just calm groups down and keep things moving forward. Again, they shouldn't have a stake in the outcome. Ideally, that's not always a possibility, particularly in smaller organizations. Prepares a process or methods for sessions. They discourage premature closure. So in other words, hey, we're not to a solution yet. We're going to keep working on this. We're going to do a couple exercises to make sure we really got it right. And they also plan for the follow-up documentation report and any next action items that are going to come out of the meeting. For you guys, at the end of this, we have several outcomes. We want you to explain the divergent convergent thinking processes so you can resolve issues, solve a problem, or discover a great opportunity. But again, you know, it brings together with the right skill sets to do that. Explain some whole brain methods to enable purposeful and intentional creation innovation, articulate the importance of method selection, discuss value using multiple methods and series of projects, understanding limitations of relying on Einstein effect, so and actually how to avoid Einstein effect, that's probably even more important, report how we know that these methods work, demonstrate the value of errors and accidents, explain which methods are best for individual and group use, because again, remember in those tables, that's kind of where it shows some are good for one case, some are good for another case. And finally, understanding the role and the benefits of facilitation. All right, so that's all I have for you today. Thank you for attending, and I'll see you in class.